Hello friends. Welcome back to this series of lectures on cardiology for MBBS students. If you have still not subscribed to this channel, this is the time that you hit the subscribe button. Do not forget to like and comment once you complete the video. Today we will cover an interesting aspect of cardiology that has revolutionized practice of cardiology. Imaging of the heart. We can see the heart in a living human in many ways using imaging techniques. We can see the size and shape of the heart, contractility of ventricles, coronary arteries and their blood flow, pulmonary arteries, pericardial sac, mediastinum, lungs, and even the peripheral vascular system. First we will study chest X-ray. X-ray is the easiest way to see the size and shape of heart. We can also see state of the pulmonary blood vessels and lung fields. For best views, we take a chest X-ray in postero anterior view during full inspiration. Anteroposterior or AP view is done when patient is bedbound, but it results in magnified cardiac shadow. An estimate of overall heart size can be made by comparing the maximum width of the cardiac outline with the maximum internal transverse diameter of the thoracic cavity. This is called cardiothoracic ratio. Cardiomegaly is described when the cardiothoracic ratio is greater than 0.5. It can be caused by chamber dilatation, especially left ventricular dilatation, or by a pericardial effusion. We have to be, however, mindful of artifacts that can alter this ratio, and in many patients with LV dysfunction, CT ratio may be normal. Dilatation of individual cardiac chambers can be recognized by the characteristic alterations to the cardiac silhouette. Left atrial dilatation results in the following. Prominence of the left atrial appendage, creating the appearance of a straight left heart border. A double cardiac shadow to the right of the sternum. Widening of the angle of the carina, bifurcation of the trachea, as the left main bronchus is pushed upwards. Right atrial enlargement projects from the right heart border towards the right lower lung field. Left ventricular dilatation causes prominence of the left heart border and enlargement of the cardiac silhouette. Left ventricular hypertrophy produces rounding of the left heart border. Right ventricular dilatation increases heart size, displaces the apex upwards and straightens the left heart border. Lateral or oblique projections may be useful for detecting pericardial calcification in patients with constrictive pericarditis or a calcified thoracic aortic aneurysm, as these abnormalities may be obscured by the spine on the PA view. The lung fields on the chest X-ray may show congestion and edema in patients with heart failure and an increase in pulmonary blood flow, pulmonary plethora, in those with left to right shunt. In many patients, chest X-ray does not help a lot, and we can take help of another wonderful investigation called echocardiography or echo. Two-dimensional echocardiography. Echocardiography uses cardiac ultrasound, and it is obtained by placing an ultrasound transducer on the chest wall to image the heart structures as a real-time two-dimensional, sliced sections. Echo allows us to perform the rapid assessment of cardiac structure and function. Left ventricular wall thickness and ejection fraction can be estimated from two-dimensional images. Common indications for echo are assessment of left ventricular function, diagnosis and quantification of severity of valve disease, identification of vegetations in endocarditis, identification of structural heart disease in atrial fibrillation, cardiomyopathies or congenital heart disease, detection of pericardial effusion, identification of structural heart disease or intracardiac thrombus and systemic embolism. Doppler echocardiography. This depends on the Doppler principle that sound waves reflected from moving objects, such as intracardiac red blood cells, undergo a frequency shift. Velocity of blood increases across stenosed valves, and when this velocity is picked by the Doppler, it gives us an idea about the degree of stenosis. The speed and direction of the red cells can be detected not only in the heart chambers but also in the great vessels. The greater the frequency shift, the faster the blood is moving. The information can be displayed in two forms. Velocity against time plot at a particular point. Two-dimensional real-time picture with color-coded flow. Doppler echo can be used to detect stenosis and regurgitation across valves. I will give you an example. The normal resting systolic flow velocity across the aortic valve is approximately 1 m/s. In the presence of aortic stenosis, this velocity is increased. In severe aortic stenosis, the peak aortic velocity may be increased to 5 m/s. Pressure gradient in millimeters of mercury equals 4 times the peak velocity in meters per second. In addition to the above echo techniques, the advanced techniques include 3-dimensional echocardiography. Intravascular ultrasound that defines vessel wall abnormalities and guides coronary intervention. Intracardiac ultrasound that provides high-resolution images of cardiac structures. And tissue Doppler imaging that quantifies myocardial contractility and diastolic function. Transesophageal echo. The standard transthoracic echo can sometimes produce poor images, especially in overweight or obstructive airways disease. Also, as the left atrial appendage, pulmonary veins, thoracic aorta and interatrial septum are not very well visualized by transthoracic echo. Transesophageal echocardiography uses an endoscope-like ultrasound probe which is passed into the esophagus and positioned immediately behind the left atrium. This produces high-resolution images, which makes the technique particularly valuable for investigating patients with the following. Prosthetic, especially mitral, valve dysfunction. Congenital abnormalities, for example atrial septal defect. Aortic dissection. Infective endocarditis vegetations that are too small to be detected by transthoracic echocardiography. And systemic embolism. Next topic, stress echo. Stress echo is used to investigate patients with suspected coronary heart disease who are unable to exercise and perform treadmill stress testing. Examples are knee osteoarthritis and pre-existing bundle branch block. A 2-dimensional echo is performed before and after infusion of a moderate to high dose of an inotrope such as dobutamine. Myocardial segments with poor perfusion become ischemic and contract poorly under dobutamine-induced tachycardiac stress, showing as a wall motion abnormality on the scan. After knowing basics of how echo is useful in diagnosis of cardiac conditions, we now move to another very important imaging investigation, CT and MRI. Computed tomographic, CT imaging. CT is useful for imaging the cardiac chambers, great vessels, pericardium, and mediastinal structures and masses. Multi-detector scanners can acquire up to 320 slices per rotation, allowing very high-resolution imaging. CT is often performed using a timed injection of X-ray contrast to produce clear images of blood vessels and associated pathologies. Most common life-saving uses of contrast CT in diagnosis of cardiovascular conditions include pulmonary embolism and aortic dissections. Contrast scans are very useful for imaging the aorta in suspected aortic dissection and the pulmonary arteries and branches in suspected pulmonary embolism. Not only this, but newer generation multi-detector scanning allows non-invasive imaging of the epicardial coronary arteries with a spatial resolution approaching that of conventional coronary arteriography. Coronary artery bypass grafts are also well seen, and in some centers, multi-detector scanning is routinely used to assess graft patency. It is likely that CT will supplant invasive coronary angiography for the initial elective assessment of patients with suspected coronary artery disease. Some centers use cardiac CT scans for quantification of coronary artery calcification, which may serve as an index of cardiovascular risk. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. This requires no ionizing radiation and can be used to generate cross-sectional images of the heart, lungs and mediastinal structures. MRI provides better differentiation of soft tissue structures than CT but is poor at demonstrating calcification. MRI scans can be gated to the ECG, allowing the scanner to produce moving images of the heart and mediastinal structures throughout the cardiac cycle. MRI is very useful for imaging the aorta, including suspected dissection, and can define the anatomy of the heart and great vessels in patients with congenital heart disease. It is also useful for detecting infiltrative conditions affecting the heart. Physiological data can be obtained from the signal return from moving blood that allows quantification of blood flow across regurgitant or stenotic valves. It is also possible to analyze regional wall motion in patients with suspected coronary disease or cardiomyopathy. The right ventricle is difficult to assess using echocardiography because of its retrosternal position but is readily visualized with MRI. MRI can also be employed to assess myocardial perfusion and viability. When a contrast agent such as gadolinium is injected, areas of myocardial hypoperfusion can be identified with better spatial resolution than nuclear medicine techniques. Later redistribution of this contrast, so-called delayed enhancement, can be used to identify myocardial scarring and fibrosis. This can help in selecting patients for revascularization procedures or in identifying those with myocardial infiltration such as that seen with sarcoid heart disease and right ventricular dysplasia. Another 30 to 40 year old modality for visualizing heart is cardiac catheterization. This involves passage of a catheter via a vein or artery into the heart under X-ray guidance, which allows the measurement of pressure and oxygen saturation in the cardiac chambers and great vessels, and the performance of angiograms by injecting contrast media into a chamber or blood vessel. Left heart catheterization involves accessing the arterial circulation via the radial or femoral artery, to allow catheterization of the aorta, left ventricle and the coronary arteries. Coronary angiography is the most widely performed procedure, in which the left and right coronary arteries are selectively cannulated and imaged, providing information about the extent and severity of coronary stenosis, thrombus and calcification. This permits planning of percutaneous coronary intervention and coronary artery bypass graft surgery. Left ventriculography can be performed during the procedure to determine the size and function of the left ventricle and to demonstrate mitral regurgitation. Aortography helps define the size of the aortic root and thoracic aorta, and can help quantify aortic regurgitation. Left heart catheterization can be completed as a day-case procedure and is relatively safe, with serious complications occurring in fewer than 1 in 1,000 cases. Right heart catheterization is used to assess right heart and pulmonary artery pressures, and to detect intracardiac shunts by measuring oxygen saturations in different chambers. For example, a step up in oxygen saturation from 65% in the right atrium to 80% in the pulmonary artery is indicative of a large left to right shunt that might be due to a ventricular septal defect. Cardiac output can also be measured using thermodilution techniques. Left atrial pressure can be measured directly by puncturing the interatrial septum from the right atrium with a special catheter. For most purposes, however, a satisfactory approximation to left atrial pressure can be obtained by wedging an end hole or balloon catheter in a branch of the pulmonary artery. Swan-Ganz balloon catheters are often used to monitor pulmonary wedge pressure as a guide to left heart filling pressure in critically ill patients. The last investigative modality in this series is radionuclide imaging. The availability of gamma-emitting radionuclides with a short half-life has made it possible to study cardiac function non-invasively. Two techniques are available: blood pool imaging and myocardial perfusion imaging. Blood pool imaging. The isotope is injected intravenously and mixes with the circulating blood. A gamma camera detects the amount of isotope-emitting blood in the heart at different phases of the cardiac cycle, and also the size and shape of the cardiac chambers. By linking the gamma camera to the ECG, information can be collected over multiple cardiac cycles, allowing gating of the systolic and diastolic phases of the cardiac cycle, the left and right ventricular ejection fraction, the proportion of blood ejected during each beat can then be calculated. The reference value for left ventricular ejection fraction depends on the method used but is usually greater than 60%. Myocardial perfusion imaging. This technique involves obtaining CT scans of the myocardium at rest and during stress after the administration of an intravenous radioactive isotope such as 99 technetium tetraphosmin. More sophisticated quantitative information is obtained with positron emission tomography (PET) which can be used to assess myocardial metabolism, but this is only available in a few centers. With this, we come to the end of this lecture on the imaging of the heart for MBBS students. Hope you enjoyed the video. For more videos like this, do not forget to like and subscribe the channel. Do post your comments and queries related to the topic. Also, suggestions are invited for the improvement of videos in future.